I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never would have made it. Never could have made it with.
Finish the race. Finish the race. By a show of hands, just so we can kind of paint a little picture. How many of y'all here ran track before? By a show of hands. How many of y'all, keep them hands up, keep them hands up. How many of y'all here ran track before? Keep them up, keep them up. Okay, now, how many of y'all, even though you didn't run track, are familiar with track running? Witness somebody run track or, you know, a little something about track running right now, right now? Okay, okay, okay. Y'all got it. I'm trying to paint a little picture here. Okay, now, once again, the title of this one is best is finish the race. Finish the race. So now, I just want everybody to picture themselves being on the track already said quite a few of y'all have been on the track before. So that's not an unfamiliar thing to you. And then the rest of y'all have witnessed, you know, seen somebody running on the track or whatnot. Now those of you who've been on the track, you notice that there's a few other people that's running with you. Especially, you know, the one with, you know, you got the baton and stuff, you know, these are the people that's supposed to be on your team. You know, you get them the baton and they keep running and, you know, y'all all working together to meet the finish line. To get to the finish line. But you also recognize that you have other people that's running on the track, which is not on the same team. And these people are trying to beat you and they don't want you to finish. You also notice that you have bleachers. You have a stand where you have the spectators and everybody watching. But on most tracks, the stand might be kind of, you know, spaced out. You might have one set of bleachers over here, and then you have another set of bleachers way over here. But I want you to picture these bleachers being right on the side of the track. You know, almost as if, you know, there's no room in between the track and the bleachers. So these spectators that normally would be quite a distance from you, they got a chance to be right up on you now. They right up on you. I also want you to picture that while you're running on this track, it ain't daytime. But normally when you, know, when you're having track meets and all that, it's always in the daytime so you can see.
Yeah.
But on this track, you can't really see. Right. That's why the Word of God tells us, say, we walk by faith and not by sight.
Right.
And on this run, on this race, we're going to come to realize that we need to be walking instead of running. But you're going to continue to have people that instead of running on the side of you, and when they see you walking, they're going to look at you like you're crazy.
Yeah.
It's called a race life because it's over so fast. Sometime before you just blink your eyes good, it's over. That's why it's described as a race, as a vapor, as a shadow, as a wind that blows that you see no more, or feel no more, rather. A wind that blows that is no more. On this race, there are going to be many trials and tribulations. There's going to be many adversaries that you going to face. Keep in mind that you already can't see. You're running and you're walking, but you really don't know where you're going. But if we think about Jesus and claiming the victory in him, we know that no matter what we run into or what we face, long as we claim the victory in Jesus, we will be victorious. And it don't matter if we can see what's in front of us or not, because we got to keep on going. We got to keep on going. It don't matter what the spectators throw at you, because they're going to throw stuff at you from the audience. They're going to hit you with everything they can. They're going to throw cans at you, nachos and sticks and stones and all kind of stuff. And then it's not just the spectators on the side of you, it's the people that's running with you too.
Yeah.
To keep in mind, you got people that's supposed to be on the same team as you. So let's keep bringing the picture here. So let's say you got on a jersey that say believer, because you're a believer. You believe in God. You believe that Jesus died for the remission of your sins, and that he rose on the third day, and that if you believe in him, you will be saved and make it to the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, so that makes you a believer. So you're running with the believers. You're running with the believers. You're walking with the believers. Then you got people with jerseys on that's supposed to be, so say, the non-believers. But they in the race too. And they running. And they running. Then you got the ones with the jerseys on. It's supposed to say believers, but it say holy rollers. And they running. And they running. These are the people that have, that are confessed believers, but every time you turn around, they condemning the believers. The ones who can tell you who going to hell and who ain't. The ones who tell you who God has called and who he haven't. The ones that can tell you, you can't tell me nothing about God. These are the ones. These are the holy rollers. But they in the race too. And they running. So everybody running in the race. Most of the people don't even know where they're going. They just know where they're trying to go. But as they see you walking, believing in God, they're looking at you funny. Now, I just wanted to paint that picture for y'all. But I want as we get into the Word of God, I want y'all to keep this picture in your mind of you being on the track and you running or walking and you know you got all this stuff that's coming up against you. You got the people on the sidelines steady throwing stuff at you, trying to knock you off your feet, and then the people that you're running on the track with, they're doing the same exact thing. Whether they are on your team. The Word of God tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14, it says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. All things. A murmur is a mumble complaint. And I know a lot of us, that's all we do is complain. Every time you turn around, oh man, it's raining, so I can't do this. Oh man, my head hurts, so I can't do this. Oh man, such and such don't like me, so I can't do this.
Yeah.
But you stayed mumbling and complaining under your breath. Oh man, I stayed up all night, so I can't go to church in the morning. You stayed mumbling and complaining under your breath. A murmur also is an abnormal sound in the body, especially in the heart. So I know you heard a heart murmur. So even if you're not verbally murmuring, even if you're not mumbling and complaining under your breath, God can still feel it when it's in your heart. He can still see it when you're murmuring in your body. That's why they call it body language. Because you don't have to say a word. But your body, your flesh, your thoughts, it will reveal all that's in your heart. The Apostle Paul said he learned how to be content in whatever situation he was in. Whether he was full, whether he was hungry, whether he was homeless. Regardless of the people persecuting him and blaming him and falsely accusing him. And what he was trying to tell us is we got to learn to be the same way. Because if we can accept the persecution for the name of Jesus' sake, just like he was persecuted, then we shall also enjoy in his inheritance. Says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. Now we know to dispute is to argue, to debate, to oppose something, to doubt. So the Word of God tells us, don't complain, don't doubt, don't debate, don't argue. We got to humble ourselves. Meekness is one of the fruits of the Spirit. So no matter what we're going through in our life, no matter how challenging the situation may be, we have to learn to humble ourselves. Basically saying, we got to be able to deal with it without complaining. We got to be able to deal with it without arguing. We got to be able to deal with it without doubting. Philippians 2:15 said, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, meaning without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom ye shine as lights in the world. But keep in mind, you're on that track. You're on the track. Everybody running. Some walking, some running. Some might start running, start back walking. But you're on that track, and you got to keep moving forward. But some of the people that's passing you up, they steady looking at you because they can't see. And you hardly can see either because it's dark. But when we allow the Holy Spirit into our life, he opens our spiritual eyes. Then we can see the things that are not before seen. Then we can understand a whole lot more about where we're going and what's in front of us. So as these people running and passing us up, thinking that they are beating us out of something, thinking that, look at you and look at me, but all of a sudden they notice a light. It's a light shining. Yeah, they're running, but while they're running, they look at you and they're wondering, what is this white? What is this white man person over there? Said, holding forth the word of life, Jesus, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, rejoice in the day of the victory, rejoice in the day when I can finally meet him face to face. That I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. So Paul was saying, you know, I don't want to be just another person on the track just running. I don't want to run in vain. And neither does he want us. He said, neither does he want to labor in vain. You don't want to surrender and submit yourself unto God. Do everything that you feel God wants you to do. And then at the end of life and judgment, you know, God still tell you, well, it just wasn't enough. So Paul is saying, he said, hold forth the word of life. We got to hold tight to Jesus. We got to hold on firm. And if we don't know him for ourselves, we got to invite him into our life. We got to humbly ask Jesus to come into our life. We got to get on our knees and pour out our heart and say, if we don't know Jesus, say, Jesus, I want to get to know you. I want to feel the goodness of your righteous spirit. I want you to be the head and center of my life. I want to hold on so tight to you and never let go. I want to feel that feeling that everybody else keep telling me about that say they know you. I want to feel that feeling too, Lord. But we have to sincerely come to him. Y'all in Philippians 2? Talk to me, church. Y'all in Philippians 2? Okay, let's flip the page. Philippians 3. Verse 13, I'll be reading from there. Philippians 3, verse 13 says, brethren, I count not myself to apprehend it, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. Paul saying, I count myself not to apprehend it. Now, I know most of us, we're not really familiar with the term apprehended. I know sometimes that we heard, well, the suspect was apprehended. The police called him and he was apprehended. Meaning that they got him. So what Paul's saying here, that I'm not saying that I've received everything I can from God. I have not spiritually arrived. See, this these the holy rollers we're talking about again, that's running alongside you in the race. These are the ones who tell you that you can't tell them nothing about God. Because they feel that they done already obtained everything that God has for them, all the knowledge and wisdom feel like you can't tell them nothing. But Paul said, I'm not one of these people. Even though he was at first, until he met Jesus on the way to Damascus, he said, I'm not the one of the ones that say I have apprehended. He said, we have to forget those things that's behind us, because these are the things that keep us weighed down, keep us buried down. We got to learn to forgive the people that trespass against us so God can forgive our trespasses.
Amen, amen.
How can we move forward in God if we stay packing all this baggage along with us, all this hurt and all this pain that people have caused us for the majority of our life? We have to talk to Jesus and give it all to Jesus so he can carry that load, because that's what he said he came to do. So we have to give it all to him so that we can continue to move forward in whatever it is that God has for us. Amen? He says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. But see, a lot of people that are running on this race, that's what they're looking for too. They're looking for a prize. But they're looking for a different kind of prize. They're looking for an earthly prize. They're looking for something that man can give them. But a believer is looking for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's our prize. Say, let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded, and if in anything be otherwise minded, God shall reveal this even unto you. So the word of God is telling you here on this morning, if you're not getting the understanding of the word right now, just keep seeking the Lord and he shall reveal it to you. Say, nevertheless, I'm at 16, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of God. Now see, these are the people, I'm talking about the people who was in the race, that had on the believer jersey, that was running with the rest of the believers, that took that jersey off, and either put on one of them holy roly jerseys, or you know, one of the non-believer jerseys. You know, they not on the same team no more. They not a part of the true body of Christ. Paul said, I have told you about these people before, because at one time they was running a good race, they was fighting a good fight, but they kept dropping the baton. And the baton is your faith, that you got to keep with you at all times. And if you drop it, you got to pick it right back up and keep on going. But Paul said these people lost their faith, and therefore they couldn't continue with the race, because in order to continue with the race, you have to have faith. He said, I told you about these people before, because, you know, they were doing the right thing. He said, but now I'm crying, telling you about these people, because I don't want you to be like them. He said, now they are enemies of God. They are enemies of the cross of Christ. You got people running around, you think it's a peace sign, but it's actually an upside down Jesus. Worshippers of Satan. Now I'm not saying all peace signs, because some of them, you know, people actually really saying peace, but I'm saying you have to be careful, because you got worshipers of Satan that use this as an example of what they feel is an upside down Jesus, saying that they claim the victory over Jesus. Enemies of the cross of God. The word of God goes on to say, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Because they're not worried about what God has for them. They're worrying about what they can attain on this earth, what kind of riches they can have, how much money we can have put up in the bank, how many fancy cars we can have, all the different the lusts of our flesh. Not saying there's nothing wrong with having a nice car and money, but I'm saying we can't put none of that before God. Word of the Lord says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. But we have to accept Jesus for his blood to be effective in our life. We have to accept him. And my wife said earlier, said, who wants peace? Everybody should want peace. But peace, the word tells us, in 1 Colossians 1:20, that peace was made through his blood, through the blood of the cross. That's how peace came into this world, through the blood of Jesus' cross. Jesus is known as the second Adam, because through the first Adam, sin entered into the world. And through the second Adam, which is Jesus Christ, he took sin from the world, from you, if you accept him. The word of God also says that the testator, which is the person that gives the testimony, must die in order for the testimony to be effective, which means that you have to be born again. You have to be a born again Christian for your testimony to be effective. You have to be willing to sacrifice your life. Word of God says no greater love than for a friend to give his life for a friend. It don't just mean running out in front of a car and getting hit and dying. It don't just mean that. But it means changing your life, consciously and willingly giving up all of the things of the world that you know are evil, in order to be an example for your friends and for your loved ones and family. 1 John 5:4 says, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? That's just the word of God confirming again that we have to be born again. We have to be born again in order to claim the victory in Christ Jesus. The word of God tells us in John 16:33, it says, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus saying, I've already done it for you. So all the things that keep you confused and frustrated every day, all the things that have you burdened down, he said, if you believe in me, I have already overcome all of these things for you. The word of God tells us in Ecclesiastes 9:11 says, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. The word of God is trying to tell us that in this race, in this life, it's not about your physical being. No matter how fast you are, no matter how strong you are, it's about your spiritual being. You run it, and you run it, and you see all of these spectators on the side of you, all of these people in the race running along with you. Sometimes you might fall, but you just never know who's coming along. Coming around that corner on that track, that's believing in God, might help come and pick you up.
Amen.
It something else going on this track. But if we're not in tune with the word of God, we won't see it. Hebrews 12:1 tells us, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. So not only is all these spectators and people around us trying to pull us down and throw stuff at us, but look up, look in the sky. Yeah. Say, there's a great cloud of witnesses right there, angels of God that are right there helping you along in this race. Angels that's taking your prayers to God. Angels that's bringing you messages from God. Angels that's helping to protect you from the enemies of God. But if we're not in tune with the Holy Spirit and our mind is not on God, we ain't going to see these things. All we're going to see is the people that's steady trying to knock us down from day to day. And that's what our mind is going to be concentrated and focused on. But God said he got a great cloud of witnesses right there with you. To help you, to aid you, to protect you. We can't keep focused on the other people that's on the track. That's trying to hold us down. That's trying to knock us down. We can't focus on the storms that we face while we walking on this track. How tough or rough the weather might get. We got to stay focused on that straight and narrow path that our Lord said few shall find. We got to keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. We got to finish the race. Take you right here, and then we're going to close. 2 Timothy 4, 6 through 8. Scripture lovers, turn with me. If you don't love the scripture, begin to love it. Praise God. Praise God. 2 Timothy verse 4, chapter 4, verse 6 through 8, it reads, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. And in some translations, they say, I have finished my race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them. To all them also that love is appearing. What did Jesus say when he was on the cross? It is finished. It is done. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters in Christ, never finish the race. Made it.
Never could have made it. Without you, I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never.